We'll put our first foot forward into DSP in this video with a gentle introduction to filtering. We'll use the algorithmic blocks that we saw in the last video to build a simple filter. The most basic filter design features one delay register, one adder, and two scalar multipliers. And a common filter topology that's used is a feedforward filter. The input signal passing through this topology will be split up into two different paths. A direct path to the adder, multiplied or weighted by an amplifier with a coefficient of A0. And a delayed path through the one sample delay, weighted with a coefficient of A1. The two signal paths merge back together, and the output of the circuit is the sum of the direct path and the delayed path. So that will be A0 times x of n plus A1 times x of n minus 1, because it's been delayed. This is also called the difference equation of the filter. The term difference equation doesn't really imply any subtraction, it's just what it's called. It expresses the characteristics of the filter and gives us a relationship between the input and the output. The order of the structure is related to the number of delay elements in a signal path. There is a single one-sample delay in the structure, and hence it's a first-order filter. And you can tell why the structure is called feed-forward. The input branches out, feeds into the summer. The signal flows from the input to the output. There is no feedback from the output to the input, which is a trait of the feedback filters that we'll see later. Let's look at a concrete example of this filter. Let's assign values to the coefficients A0 and A1. Let's say both A0 and A1 are 0.5. What would this filter do? What are its frequency and phase responses? In order to analyze this filter, we'll take the tedious but easy approach. We discussed the digital test signals that we'd use in the previous video. The approach here is to take each one of these signals, manually push the samples of the signal through the filter, one sample at a time, and study the output. So we have 5 test signals to go through. These are the DC signal, or the 0 Hz signal, the Nyquist signal, the half Nyquist and quarter Nyquist signals, and impulse signal. While analyzing the filter response for an input signal, for each audio sample that enters the structure, the sample is read in, and the output is formed by the addition of the direct weighted sample and the previous sample that was in the delay register. Incidentally, the delay register is overwritten with the sample that was read. Let's start with the first signal, the DC or step signal. The input sample series is 0 followed by a steady stream of 1s. Let's iterate through the samples and see what we get. The first sample that enters is 0. So using the difference equation, the output signal is just the direct sample, whose value is 0 multiplied by the coefficient of A0, which is 0.5, added to the delayed sample that was previously in the register. Now, since this is the very first pass through the filter, there was nothing that was previously in the register. In this case, a default steady state of 0 is passed. This value is multiplied by the coefficient A1, and hence the resulting output sample is just 0, which is not very interesting. So, for the first input sample of 0, the output sample is 0. Now, we need to update the state of the delay register with the value that was passed. So, we set the state of the register to 0. Next, in the input series, we have 1. So, calculating the difference equation, the direct path is 1 times 0.5. And in the delayed path, the previous state was 0. So, the delayed path results in 0. The output is 0.5. Let's update the state of the register again, and this time it's 1. Next pass, we have 1, so the direct path remains the same, 1 times 0.5, and in the delayed path, the previous state was 1, and so the result is, again, 1 times 0.5. The output of the difference equation is 1, and we update the state register to a value of 1. After this sample, every other sample would yield the same result of output equals to 1, since the input signal doesn't alter. So, for an input sequence like this, we get an output sequence which is quite similar, where the output amplitude eventually settles out to be a constant of 1 or unity gain condition. So at DC or 0 Hz, the output equals the input. However, there is a 1 sample delay in the response, causing the leading edge of the step input to be smeared out by 1 sample. This is called time smearing and is a normal consequence of filtering. This gives us the first rule of feedforward filters. The amount of time smearing is equal to the maximum delayed path through the feedforward branches. Next, we'll repeat the process for the Nyquist frequency signal. The signal basically has 2 sample points for each period. The filter behaves in an entirely different way when processing the Nyquist frequency, but we can spot the pattern after only a few iterations. So I'll let the animation take over here so that I don't have to explain the process 1 sample at a time. But if you do feel confused at any point, just skip back and check it out again. You can see that the output completely disappears after the first sample period. The phase is kind of hard to characterize because the signal has vanished. Why did the amplitude drop all the way to 0 at Nyquist? The answer is one of the keys to understanding digital filter theory. The 1 sample delay introduced exactly a 180-degree phase shift at the Nyquist frequency and caused it to cancel out when recombined with the input branch. This leads us to the next rule. Delay elements create phase shifts in the signal. The amount of phase shift depends on the amount of delay as well as the frequency of the input signal. In the case of the Nyquist signal, the 1 sample delay is exactly enough to cancel out the original signal when they're both added together in equal ratios. But what about other frequencies? Let's look at the half Nyquist signal. By now, you should have an idea on how to perform this laborious manual sample-by-sample calculation, so I'll skip that bit and provide a table of values instead. But I'd strongly encourage you to give it a shot yourself. Pause this video, take a pen and paper, and calculate this by hand for both the half Nyquist and the quarter Nyquist frequencies. And then you can get back. This will solidify the concepts of signal path and structure analysis that we are discussing here. So here's the output for the half Nyquist frequency signal. The half Nyquist signal basically has 4 sample points per period, and the output, unlike the output of the Nyquist signal, has a repeating pattern. Though the peak sample value registered is 0.5 on the positive axis and a negative 0.5 on the negative axis, if you try to inscribe a sinusoid through it, we get something like this. The peak of the sinusoid is around 0.7. You can notice that at the very start, the output isn't a perfect sinusoid. It's been dragged and stretched through time. This is basically the time smearing artifact of the filter that we discussed earlier. So, what happened here? How did we get to this output? Well, phase shifting. For the half Nyquist signal, the 1 sample delay created a 90-degree phase shifted signal. Unlike the Nyquist frequency, which was 180-degree phase shifted and completely cancelled each other out, this signal is only partially phase shifted and hence will produce an output. We can visualize this property in Desmos, which is a graphing calculator. Let's try and simulate the difference equation of the filter here. F of x is equal to sine of x. Let's say that this is our half Nyquist frequency sinusoidal signal. Let's weight this by a factor of 0.5, which is the coefficient A0. Then, we need to add this signal to the output of the delay branch. Let's call the output of the delay branch as g of x. And for now, let's just associate this with 0.5 times sine of x, which is the same as the direct path. If there was no phase shift at all,
the output would be a simple addition of f of x and g of x, and we get a fully reconstituted output signal where the input is equal to the output. This is what happened to the 0 Hz signal. There was zero phase shift. For low frequency signals as well, the phase shift would be very negligible. But for our signal, the half Nyquist frequency, the delay branch would phase shift the signal by 90 degrees. So let's factor that in. 90 degrees is pi over 2 radian, and by using this as the shift factor, and then adding the signals together, we get an output signal whose peak value is 0.707, just what we observed earlier. Moreover, we can see that although the delay block caused a 90 degree phase shift in the original signal, the phase offset of the output signal is less than that. We can calculate what the phase shift is between the input and the output signals here. The peak of the output is at 3 pi over 4, and the peak of the input is at pi over 2. So the phase difference is pi over 4 radian, or 45 degrees. Going back to our sample diagram, we can see the same phase shift here of 45 degrees. Let's finish off with one last signal for this video, and we'll do it quickly. With the output response of this signal, we won't learn anything new, but we'll hopefully be able to see a clearer trend developing. So our input signal is a quarter Nyquist frequency signal. This signal has 8 sample values per period, and when it's passed through the filter, we get this as the output. Analyzing this, since the quarter Nyquist signal has 8 sample points, the one sample delay will cause a phase shift of 1/8, which is 45 degrees of shift. So let's go back to our graphing calculator again and see what the sum of the direct signal and a 45 degree phase shifted signal would look like. Well, this is it. As you can see, its peak value is around 0.92 at 5 pi over 8 radian. So the phase difference between the output and the input, which was at pi over 2 radian, is pi over 8 radian, which is 22.5 degrees. Going back to the sample diagram, we see the same. The sinusoid that can be inscribed within the sample points of the output signal has a peak at around 0.9 and a phase shift of 22.5 degrees, and the same time smearing artifact at the start. Now that we have a few data points to work with, let's put them together within a plot to visualize them. Let's start with a frequency response plot, with frequency on the x-axis and output amplitude on the y. And let's plot the output amplitudes of each of the signals we observed. The 0 Hz signal was untouched by the filter, so the amplitude of the output remains the same as that of the input, so it's 1. At the Nyquist frequency, the signal vanished, so we can mark it as 0. At the half Nyquist, we observed the peak level of the output sinusoid was 0.707, and at the quarter Nyquist, it was around 0.92. If we smoothly interpolate between these points, we get the frequency response of what looks like a low-pass filter. In fact, this feed-forward filter topology that we built, with its coefficients as 0.5 and 0.5, is a low-pass filter. It lets the lower frequencies through unchanged while attenuating higher frequencies. At the half Nyquist frequency, the signal level is 0.707 on the linear scale. But on the logarithmic scale, it's 20 times log of 0.707. which is negative 3 decibels. So the cutoff frequency of this filter is fixed at half the Nyquist frequency. We didn't account for the cutoff frequency anywhere. This frequency is solely determined by the coefficients that we've used, A0 and A1. Changing them will remarkably change the frequency response of the filter. We'll play around with different coefficient values with an actual audio plugin later on. But now, let's look at the phase response of the filter. The phase response is a straight line, with no phase shift at 0 degrees, to a 90 degree phase shift at the Nyquist frequency. This is called a linear phase response, and is not a very common thing to see in filtering. In fact, this simple filter design is a linear phase filter, but only under certain conditions. A feed-forward filter will always be a linear phase filter if its coefficients are symmetrical about their center. In this case, the coefficients that we've chosen for A0 and A1 are 0.5 and 0.5, and they're symmetrical. Another example would be negative 0.25 and 0.25. Linear phase filters are interesting for two reasons. First, they preserve the time domain shape of the input signal in the output. This kind of response cannot be obtained from analog filters or in IIR filters, which we'll study later on. Second, this kind of filter has useful applications where phase linearity across the spectrum is important, such as filters for loudspeaker crossovers or in multiband effect processors. We'll dedicate a video to talk more about linear phase soon enough. But for this section, we still have one more signal to go through, the impulse signal. I had hinted at the significance of the impulse signal very briefly in an earlier video. So before we subject our filter to an impulse signal, let's actually discuss what makes this signal so special and so unique.